focusing on and stuff, but would you like to do a little introduction to yourself as well?
Yeah, cool. So thank you so much for mentioning. My name is Omolola. Everyone calls me Lola, so everyone can call me Lola. My pronouns are she, her, hers. I'm based in sunny Brooklyn, New York.
You kind of side-eyed that when you did it.
Yeah, I mean, today it's sunny and we're grateful, but in New York it's fall, so the weather's kind of fluctuating a little bit here and there. You never know.
Yeah. Oh, you never know. And hopefully, yeah, the internet is working, thankfully. So I've obviously loads of questions for you this evening,
Great.
and I'm sure that many people will also have loads of questions for you. The way I actually found you was through winemag.com,
Yeah.
for the article you wrote based on the ideas of the online and the offline beverage industry and communities. But for my initial question is, what initially inspired you to start Black Girl? What is Black Girls Drink, and why did you start it?
Cool. Yeah, Black Girls Drink. So I've been a hospitality professional for about 5 years now, and I've worked in marketing probably on and off since about 2006. And when I walked into hospitality, I quickly noticed that there didn't seem to be a lot of people that looked like me. And there lacked conversations specifically around like me as a black cis woman, like what are my interests, what are my passions, what am I drinking, what am I eating and consuming and stuff. And I saw there to be an opportunity to like raise those conversations up and to hold them. And that's kind of what Black Girls Drink has been about right now, has been building a platform where we can like elevate black women and black non-binary folk that are in beverage, who love beverage, who are curious about beverage. This is a platform, meant to elevate the professionals that are already here and then to create conversation for people that are just interested.
Yeah, like
So basically I saw a gap, and I was like, that's why I mentioned the marketing part. I saw a gap, I saw opportunity. You know what? Let's have those conversations. And it's really
yeah.
cool. Super fun.
And like the thing, like obviously, I also work in marketing. My name is Susie, for anyone who doesn't know, she and her as well. And it is that thing of I did quite a lot of research into like the beverage industry this week, and into even how the stereotypes around espresso and filter coffee and hospitality and everything else like that. And it's such a humongous thing to even approach that you've started your own community, which is probably this like the best thing you can do, because it's such a thing to, like, it's such a giant whale of a thing to approach. And
Gigantic.
like, did you, for me, I think I noticed that you focused a lot on not just the online and offline industries, but also how your experiences of even ordering a drink.
I mean, thanks, Susie. First, thanks for like having like reading the article itself, and I hope other people will check it out just as a quick plug. And thanks to Emily Saladino, who is the editor on the piece. It was super cool with wine enthusiasts to give me the opportunity to have those conversations. I think it's definitely been frustrating for me as on the consumer end of things, right? So even before going in the industry, when I would walk into a restaurant or just walk into a restaurant and want to place an order and first either being ignored, unless you're doing like the thing, dressed up super extra cute, doing a thing, like outside of that, there has been countless experiences by myself with other friends of mine who are black and like where we weren't genuinely appreciated or seen as a consumer. And then a lot of assumptions around what I want to drink. And I feel like that's kind of why I made that like specific point about Pinot Noir is like, I love a glass of Pinot Noir, but how many times have I been offered like a super sweet cocktail, which I have no problem with actually. I'm going out for tea tonight. I love drinking. I have an expansive like profile and taste and things that I enjoy, but I think it's a mistake of any restaurant to make an assumption around a customer every single time they walk in the door. It's bad business. It's bad marketing. It's stereotyping. It reinforces stereotypes. It doesn't build relationships. Like it works against you as a business because when I, as a consumer, don't feel comfortable or welcome, I won't come back. And as a time to tell other people, I'm like, let me just tell other people, this place is not welcoming to you, you know? So.
Yeah. Yeah, it's, and for you, what did you find? Like, obviously there were super sweet cocktails and stuff, but what other, like, because I was thinking of like, what type of things do we make about, what stereotypes and what boxes do we put people in within the coffee industry, which we most definitely do. I don't think anyone could deny it.
No.
And what do you think the kind of boxes that you get put in within the industry?
Yeah. You mean within specifically the coffee industry, right?
Well, or no, for like, even within your experience of hospitality, what boxes did you feel you were put into?
Yeah, I would say inexperienced. That's like one of the boxes. Like, somehow I don't know what I want. Or the box of like, I don't know exactly how to articulate this, but funny enough, my comment is around language. I think sometimes the mistake is that like when people don't speak exactly like the language of whatever our beverage industry is, there's a mistake sometimes by a professional that like, oh, this person doesn't know what they're talking about. And it's like, no, I don't necessarily need to talk about like, I don't know, the like coffee, you know, like maybe like the length of like the roast, like how long it's been roasted, or specifically like the exact region, or like, you know, like I might not have the language exactly, but that doesn't mean that I don't know what I'm trying to express. And your job as a professional is to like try to get that out of me, you know, like talk to me, have a conversation. That's what hospitality is about, is to be hospitable, engage people.
Yeah. And
so much of that is, yeah. So I think that's probably, I would say that's the most like, oh, you're inexperienced, you lack the language, so you don't know what you're talking about. I'm like, okay, girl, I know what I'm talking about, you know?
Yeah. Actually, Jen, who is also part of Team Acaia, she just said it. She was like, elitism.
Yeah.
It's, yeah.
that is exactly it. And also gatekeeping, like gatekeeping for us is like, you know, working professionals, I think, and then gatekeeping for consumers, like, oh, you don't really know, so you're not really welcome here. It's super disturbing. It's also silly. And shout out again to WineMag, but like, even in the article I mentioned, like, marginalized communities, so specifically Black communities, disabled communities, other communities of color, women, we have a lot of buying power. So we actually are making purchases. We are actually interested in like what we're eating and what we're drinking. So maybe like how the hospitality kind of frames it, like there's a lack of education, or we don't know what we want or what we're thinking about, blah, blah, blah. It's more like, no, you haven't done the work. So that's why we can't meet you there. We can't go and purchase. We can't go and eat there, because it's not because I might not like foie gras. It might be, I don't like the way you talk about foie gras to me, you know?
It's
example, but I think you kind of know what I'm
talking. It's a good example, though. It's an excellent example, because I was thinking about it today on the idea of both sides of the bar, and it's something that even I used to do. We all used to, like, I feel like many of my past colleagues have done before, where you pick up two drinks. One is a milky drink, and one is like a black coffee or espresso, and you assume that by the gender of the people at the table, which one is for which.
Right.
And it's also this idea of espresso. Oh, it puts hair on your chest.
Right.
I remember offering a man a number of years ago in Germany, would you like any milk with your black coffee? And he goes, do I look like a woman? I was like, oof. Like, no. It's these gender stereotypes, but also within race and sexuality and everything else like that.
Absolutely. The layers.
It is so many layers, and it's learned behavior as well. It's absolutely. So even on that note, we're going to go into like, so you focused on a number of aspects within the beverage community, which there's so many, but it was including stereotypes and inclusion. So I was going to kind of go through three, which were space. We've kind of touched on. Customer service and marketing. And it was also the thing of marketing. I don't know if you've been watching Lovecraft Country.
I have not.
I watch it in a very well-lit room kind of thing.
Okay.
In the daytime. But it's the idea of like the even playing ideas of how you approach, like how you guide marketing towards a certain community. And kind of this idea of like, if you look back in it, like filter coffee for like serving at the home by the housewife and all this stuff. What have your been experiences of those kind of marketing and space, and how is it excluding?
Yeah, I think for me, almost anytime I make a purchase, nowadays, the first thing I do is check if the brand is on Instagram, and I check who represents the brand. And when I see that, like, there's no people of color specifically, like brown and black people, so a wide set of shades of colors, when I don't see that there are like different body types, you know, when I don't see different gender expressions, when I see any of those things are kind of like lacking, it deters me from making a purchase, and it deters me from like my interest in the brand. And so I feel like, hopefully I'm not getting lost in your question, Susie, but like,
not at all.
The application is so deep in like beverage as well. I think, you know, just touching upon like your gender stereotypes and what you were talking about, like in beer, for instance, we see a lot of like a specific type of like cis male that represents the beer brands, right? And when I see intentionality behind recognizing, accepting, and celebrating the fact that I actually love beer in your feed, it makes me more comfortable to like purchase from you. Because I think for me too, there's a relationship between your marketing and probably who's behind the scenes. If you don't think about me as far as who you're having the conversations, you're probably not thinking about those people in hiring them or in the way that they're treated in the workplace. So it's all kind of interrelated for me. And I think especially as a marketer, it's not only even about like the visual aspect, which is like something that's super important too, but it's even like, how's the story told? Who is the story being told about? You know, like, are the actual authors of the story being presented? You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So I think for me, like, that's kind of the bigger touch points, especially in like marketing and how it interacts with beverage. What was the other part of it that you were mentioning? Was it like you said beverage, was it community?
Ideas of community and like ideas of space as well. Like, I think the community is one of the bigger things of when trying to break into or get into an industry or get into like an interest even.
Yeah.
And I think I believe like the idea that there's always been that idea that beer is for men or beer is for, it's like, or like certain drinks are for certain people of certain races, and all this idea of like white wine is for housewives,
right?
white is cis housewives. What kind of ones have you, like, what have you experienced? Because you're like, especially since you've started Black Girls Drink, what has been any pushback that you've found?
You know, thankfully, it could be the size of my platform since it's growing. chance as of right now, I wouldn't say there's been much pushback, to be honest. Also, maybe I don't pay attention enough to like the hateration that floats around in the world, even though I spend a lot of time on Twitter and
I just love the word hateration.
Yeah. I'm talking about a couple of words that I like to make up, so there's definitely a lot of hate, just generally speaking, when I'm perusing the internets. There are counter conversations around like, let's not politicize food, beverage, or any of our spaces, right? There is general pushback. I see it all the time. Like, I saw a friend of mine had made a comment around, she's in some sort of Facebook group, and where they like share jokes on beer, because she works in the beer industry. And so she shared one of those jokes, but she had like blanked out the people that had shared it. And she was like, hey, beer Twitter, like, this reinforces gender stereotypes. I don't appreciate it. Doesn't create space for me to feel comfortable here. And like, I read the list of people that responded to her tweet, like, oh my gosh, you're being so dramatic. And like, oh, this is obnoxious, or like this again type of stuff. And I think it's super, it's frustrating and it's disappointing from like our counter from like our counterparts, depending on what your identity is. So like for me, my other racial counterparts, my other gender counterparts, how they're not affirming, because ultimately they are the stakeholders that we're looking to like move on these issues. It's not Black people that are holding back Black people from like operating successfully in beverage and food. You know what I'm saying? It is like, it is white business owners. It is white male business owners. It's like white male cis business owners. That's who we're talking about. So yeah, I see the hate. It is frustrating. It's ugly. It's disappointing, sometimes unsurprising, but I do believe that they're like, I mean, I know that we said we were going to talk about this a little bit, but I do think there's been a general awakening recently in the US, especially around Black lives, and that from what I've seen, some responses, yes, have felt hollow and temporary, but there have been some industries and some actions that I feel have been substantive and sustained, which is, that's what we want. That's what we need.
Yeah.
Ongoing conversations. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. You, like, it's the thing of like wanting change instead of this is your temporary Facebook profile photo or something like that is what I feel like a lot of places do, unfortunately. Right. And like from the perspective of like living in Germany, it's this thing of watching the industry change, that in this, like the coffee industry and the beverage industry and the, like the States as a whole change from a distance and from a almost like a third person description of this is how everything is going kind of thing. Yeah. And we did actually touch on that in like in our prep questions. There's like so many questions to have. Do you think like the Black girl, like the Black Lives Matter movement, has it changed the beverage industry at all? And if it has, how has it done that?
Yeah. It's hard to say, right? Because I imagine same thing for you in Germany, but like in the US, there's still places that are shut down. So for the experience of like how these businesses now operationalize or you know share their like commitment to the Black community has been a little bit stunted because a lot of places aren't open. But I think there's been some deeper conversations, and I truly appreciate it, that I've seen from different brands, and so that I would say that it has caused a shift. To say if the shift is super deep and sustained, that part I'm not ready to like too much comment on, because I feel like it's unknown. We're still in it. And it's hard to reconcile at times, but like, you know, being a Black person, it's super great that we're having conversations. For me, I'm like, okay, I don't know if I should say my age, but I've been living in my own identity for over 30 years. And like, you had an awakening in March. Welcome. But you know, there's been a whole lifetime of like, you know, issues, situations, problems, and injustices that I've encountered. And so, you know, you're just kind of like, it's hard. It's hard to say like, what does immediate reconciliation look like? But I think it's just kind of step by step, having those conversations. Vulnerability on the other sides of the aisle will push us forward for sure.
Yeah, for sure. Like it's actually really wild to see how much news is coming out of the US right now. Like we're not going to go into politics because we could be
Why
here
not?
All night.
No,
we could be here all night. We of course can touch on it because it's this thing that is like, it is this kind of thing that let's segue kind of thing, because of everything that's happening in the States at the moment, there is a lot of kind of Zoom parties and everyone moving. The idea of kind of personal space is now the public space, if you get what I mean. The idea of like, we're kind of doing this thing of Zoom parties, Zoom drinking parties. We had a big issue in Europe, or are about to have an issue again, where people were kind of turning to alcohol during the lockdowns and stuff. What are your thoughts on kind of how everyone has started doing these drinking together on Zoom? What are your thoughts on it, and like, has Black Girls Drink kind of had any approach to it as well?
Wow, it's such a great question. Unexpected, but I love it. I have not actually hosted any Zoom parties this year since basically March. But I do have thoughts on, I think definitely we need more space for like spirit free consumption and valuing that, you know, and like, and also, yeah, I think that's generally where like, it's fine if people don't want to drink alcohol. I get where the pressure comes from, but I think that there needs to be a raised level of education basically for consumers and, you know, for community groups, et cetera, around how do we thoughtfully include a wide range of people? Because there are people that are sober. They want to sit on a Zoom party and have the community and have the friendship, have the conversations, but alcohol they don't want to have a part of it. They don't want to drink alcohol, which is great. So, you know, encouraging people to find thoughtful, creative beverages that are without spirits. And like, I mean, for me, it feels super easy. I love picking up a shrub. You know, my friend Jade is actually releasing like a set of like shrubs soon. And she gave me some to sample. They're so good. And I love
that. Can I ask what a shrub is?
Yeah.
I don't know.
No, great question. It's a vinegar-based drink. So like, I don't actually know exactly how they make it, but to my understanding, it's, now I'm trying to think about exactly how to describe it. I just described it as like vinegar-based, you know, usually either fruit or vegetal, you know, sometimes herb. And it's like kind of made into like a potent concentrate. And then you dilute it with like tonic or soda water or regular water if you want. And it offers the same depth of cocktails if you really enjoy cocktails, you know. Oh, someone said shrubs are delicious. Yeah. Thanks, friend. If you want to describe it for everyone too, I welcome that. But like you can, they offer the same like depth and like kind of creativity as like what cocktails can offer you. And they're super great and they're healthy. They're wonderful. And they don't come with sugar. So you can enjoy that. I feel like that's always a great like go-to. For me, I've taken to really getting back into my water drinking, you know, cause like, sometimes you just get caught up through the day. And so that's also a great option at night. I hope that doesn't feel super silly, but like, you know, when I'm on parties with friends, I just try to be mindful. I don't pressure people. Like I do Zoom parties with a lot of my girlfriends. Right. And like, we do drink cocktails, beer, whatever, but we also have space where it's like, I don't want to drink. Okay, girl, like drink your water, enjoy it. Drink your bubbly water or drink just regular water. That's also okay.
Yeah.
But Black Girls Drink does not have a particular stance. I do agree it is an issue.
Yeah. But it's just like, I think the idea of Black Girls Drink is, what my feeling when first reading your descriptions of it was the idea that, as you said, it was the idea of Black people and non-binary people getting into the idea that they are also interested in the drinks industry and have a space there. Because it is that idea of it is a hierarchy. I use the hierarchy thing of like, it's a hierarchy of like, it's a lot of white cis men who own these beer and wine and industries. And it's also so many very old industries as well.
Right.
Because there's a lot of heritage and 100-year-old gins and all this kind of stuff.
Right.
And how have you like...
Thanks, April. Okay.
Yeah. For the idea of like non-binary people, have you seen like the and kind of how people are coming in? Are you seeing any change at all?
Yeah, I'm seeing some change as far as people being more thoughtful, like, you know, how we introduce ourselves with our gender pronouns, right? I think I wanna be mindful that some people might not feel comfortable always expressing their identity because we literally have laws that harm people of varying gender identities in the US. I can't say specifically for Germany, right? So, so I think, but I do think that generally speaking, at least in the beverage space, I've known a few friends that are non-binary, and I would say that they have expressed that they don't always feel comfortable, that we still have steps to go. And I really do defer to them as much as, like, I think that we should defer to the voices that are Black to speak on Black issues. So I defer to them to, like, speak more on, like, what that means to them. But from the conversations I've had with friends, yes, there's still so many steps to go.
Yeah. Like, here, I can't remember if it's here or, like, another local country. Mm-hmm. I believe we have a third gender here. So you can put, male, female on the, we have, I can't remember what the word is, but we have a word for, like, third gender. Yeah. Like, like unisex or, like, undescribed or something. And, yeah, like, we have, like, I'm a very big advocate here for craft beer and for natural wine and stuff like that. But there have been, like, not within the natural wine industry, it's been okay, but I have noticed a pushback or a sort of a closed community within the beer community for sure. That's across it, but it's changing, but change comes slow if you want it to be something.
my friend Tony just commented, like, it's hard as a non-binary person because people still see the gender spectrum as binary. You know, I think that's it. Like, that's ultimately it. It's like, we as in cis people lack an understanding of that you're not just falling into, like, one or two categories of, like, gender identity, right? And I think as hospitality professionals, and again, like what I was saying earlier, Susie, it's hard because we're not back in restaurants actively, right? But as hospitality professionals, people are still trained on, like, walking up to tables and saying, hey guys, or what's up girls, or, like, you know, reinforcing stereotypes from the very beginning of a hospitality experience. And that is super, that's harmful, it's hurtful, it's also lazy, you know, it's lazy hospitality. Like, that goes against, it's not good hospitality. It's terrible. It's being a terrible person, and it's also bad hospitality. You should never make an assumption that who you're looking at and what their gender identity is of any person that you meet, because you don't know. People can present in any sort of way, and that might not be their gender identity. And that's not for, like, me to decide, that's for that person. And see, Tony made a really great point. I hope you don't mind, Susie, but Tony said,
yeah, no, of course,
there are a lot of, there are a lot of things for women, and it makes me more comfortable when Lola and others include non-binary folks in their initiatives. Thanks, Tony. That's super kind of you. And I feel like that's, for me, exactly why I said that in starting Black Girls Drink, you know, and I recognize it does say the word Black Girls Drink, but it really is a platform to elevate also my non-binary people, you know, and, like, because they are also excluded from the general narrative around consumption. Like, I can't even really think of, like, a brand that I think that does it super well, like a beverage brand or something like that, where, like, you know, when we think of, like, brand representatives and people and brand ambassadors and things like that, I honestly can't think of someone that really elevates, like, a non-binary person, and that's disappointing, you know? And I would hope that sometime in the future that, thanks, Unity, coffee. Hey, everyone is better. I agree. Hey, everyone. Hey, people. Hey, folks. I like to say hello, folks, you know, welcome.
Yeah, and it's, like, for me, I was, like, even on the idea of kind of judging when you see someone, and especially the language you use around them, and the way, like, the whole idea of hospitality and speaking with someone is to make them feel welcome. Like, this is the whole idea, is that you want them to keep coming back and spend their money. And it's the whole idea of kind of, I was thinking about what are the stereotypes and what are the assumptions that we make within the coffee industry. And there's a lot, of course. It's the idea that milk, to have milk is to be feminine, to have anything sweet. This is also within the beverage industry, the idea of having anything sweet is feminine. The idea of anything low calorie is feminine, unless it's straight. Like, unless the irony of, like, if it's like, unless it's straight. And this kind of thing of how, like, this is a question for you as well. Like, it's this idea of how we somehow gendered and rate, like, and kind of stereotype the idea of flavors and textures.
Like, I think.
Yeah, no, go ahead.
Oh, okay. It's a super reductive approach. And it's also sad. I can't say I feel bad, generally speaking, for like white cis men or something like that. But I think sometimes I feel sorry for men out there that like you have to eat and drink in a certain way in order to reinforce someone's perspective of you and your ability to like perform and be successful in this world, you know? And same thing, like women, non-binary folk, we're boxed in that like we're expected, we won't even have, when we walk into like a dining experience, that we won't even have any knowledge around like just drinking a spirit straight up, right? Or just drinking coffee black, or that we lack that desire. And I don't know. It's super frustrating on the consumer end. And I know I've made this point already earlier in the conversation, but it's just like super lazy of a company and of the market and of a business. And ultimately, like you said, when people don't feel welcome, they won't come back. Like if I feel like every single time, if I give you a chance, right, and you make a mistake, and let's say you're super apologetic about it, or you seem genuinely contrite, like, you know what, I didn't, oh, of course you would like a cappuccino, or of course you would like, you know, espresso, or an Americano in black, and that's fine. But if I come back and you do it multiple times, I'm like, now, I tried. Something's got to give. Like, what do you expect out of me as a consumer, to give my money to you when you don't value me or see me or speak to me? Like, Google is available everywhere around the world. You can literally spend the time dismantling stereotypes of race and gender and socioeconomic. You can literally do that work by yourself by using the internet. I'm always confused why, like, we even have to lean on like customers coming in and people teaching us when you can actually do the work. There's so many other people that have been paid. They've written books. They've written blog posts. Like, my friend Tony's on here, and Tony's written so many beautiful posts with their group. And like you can just like Google people's names and find out their writings. So many beautiful things up there. So
yeah, it's even, I think I also thought of industry biases and bringing up examples, which I feel like we've already really touched on as well. And I would actually invite if they do have questions for us. Also, someone just wanted to mention this from April.
Okay, so I'll just take this moment to say, like, sure, I did put on some lipstick today. I'm super proud of myself. It's from Lip Bar. It's wonderful. It's a Black-owned lip brand. You can find it in Target in the U.S., and you can find it on their website. Other than that, April, thanks, boo. You inspire me, too. So I just try to be dope and fly for my people.
So this is an example of like people can use the question box if you have questions for Lola. So kind of going back to the idea of the community that you're building, how are you envisioning it? Like, where do you see it going in the future, and how are you building it?
I'm super happy you asked that question, Susie. I started off basically hosting tasting events, you know, at different spots all around in Brooklyn. And it made me happy to like create a space that was like welcoming and inclusive and didn't make assumptions about people when they walk in the door, like, hey, let's be friends. There's no, like I was mentioning, no gatekeeping in this space that I'm involved in, right? Then the next evolution for me was I dropped a list. It's on the website, blackgirlsdrink.co. Of like 100 Black women and non-binary folk that are in the industry. in all industries of beverage. So it's not just coffee. It's coffee, tea, it's shops that are owned, wine shops, it's makers of wine and beer, etc. And I think one thing that was super cool about that iteration was, for me, I already knew, but the full realization of the vast number of people that are contributing every single day to the beverage industry. I mean, it's literally propped up by Black and Brown people. It's super beautiful. For me, the next step is, well, of course, I'll do the list again next year. But the next step is I'm going to do a taste survey. So it's like a preference survey on Black women and Black non-binary folk, because I think that's one thing that I see that's super missing, like marketing materials. And I understand that in order for you to build a business and figure out like what are the directions and what feels like profitable and how you feel like you can make a step that feels like rooted in knowledge, you know, is by you having access to information. Unfortunately, the people that are normally building this type of information and tools, etc., they leave out vast groups that are out there that actually contribute to the industry. So that's the next step. I've thought of who the partner would be in executing this, but I'm gonna keep that person's name offline because I still have to have those conversations. But I'm really excited because I think it's going to show some surprising results. One is around the wide tastes that are in the Black community, and also that we're purchasers, and also that our purchases are tied into our experiences. And I think that once that idea is cemented through like literal statistics and numbers and, you know, things, fun stuff like that, then people will start to also make the change, because for whatever reason, capitalism, you know, people like how it's economically beneficial to them. I get it. It's business. Sure. America. Sure. And
I think it's like, just gesture widely there.
The whole world. We're all propped up by money, and like, you know, but the thing is, I think when you understand that our communities are also helping you make money, then you'll do a better job of speaking to us.
Yeah, like, and for you, you have the community on, do you have a community online, and then Obviously you can't do, you're not doing the tasting, are you doing the tastings right now as well?
No.
Yeah,
I've seen a lot of really great tastings. I've kind of let, you know, I've seen a lot of other friends and community members host some really great events. I've had the pleasure of attending them. I've not necessarily felt the need. A little Zoom fatigue at times. You know what I'm saying?
It's just, oh, yes. I think it's the new word for dictionary.com.
Yeah. I'm like, oh, I'm good. I don't host an event. Maybe next year when it's kind of calm down a little bit, so we'll see.
Yeah, exactly. So we already have questions.
Oh, cool.
So this is for you, I guess, and this is like, what's your favorite style of coffee?
Okay, cool. Hey, Fox Surf, good to meet you. So let's see, every single time I see notes that say, oh, favorite style of coffee, I guess I would say French press.
Mm-hmm. I think it, like, also style, like, also flavor notes is also an interesting thing as well. Yeah, because I think you're in the flavor business pretty much.
Yeah, that's true. I am in the flavor business. I like that. I wonder if I could use that into something. But yeah, so whenever I see things that say like coffee that's described as like chocolatey, nutty, let me see. I'm trying to think about caramel notes, you know, those are the descriptors that really make me feel warm and fuzzy inside. So basically medium to dark roasted coffee is really my jam. Yeah and then nice. I love French press coffee, you know, so I'll follow it,
it's
that.
To be honest, like, I think everyone, like a lot of people are in like the coffee industry, especially specialty, we're all about those light filters and everything else like that, but we all of us, like, there's not one person who's denied it. They just sometimes just want a cup of diner coffee.
Yeah.
Like, you just crave it. And it's, I believe it's the same in, like, the wine and the beer industry. Sometimes you just want, a beer you can just pick up in, like, the gas station.
Yeah, something like, simple, no frills, no drama, super stripped down. I feel like, I don't know if you've ever been to Italy, Susie, but I was lucky enough to, okay.
Yeah. I live just down the road. It's fine.
I went to Italy 2 years ago, and I was super struck by how incredibly delightful espresso was at like the train station. I was changing from Milan to I don't know where, somewhere for it was my partner's family's wedding, but and we had to stop at this train station, and there was this family. I looked like a family, like a mom and maybe two daughters. That was one of the best espresso experiences I had while I was there. And I was there for like 4 or 5 days in Italy. But it's to say, I truly do appreciate spaces and experiences that are not like hoity-toity, you know?
Yeah. Like, oh, yeah.
Why do they always have to be elevated? I love elevatedness in other moments. But sometimes I'm like, I want to put on a sweatshirt and just have a little bit of coffee. It's really not that deep. Oh, yeah,
exactly.
Yes, Steve, absolutely. See, Florence, I've never been there. Hopefully I'll go. If you tell me what train station, I can mark it down for myself.
He definitely has that known. I think probably for me, the idea of the space and hoity-toityness and such like things like that. And I think it's also the thing, it's like Black Girls Drink, it's a focus on space as well. The best espresso I ever had was in a traditional espresso bar in Lisbon, Portugal. Incredible. It was so good. I've had the most incredible espressos, but it's like, it's also like the idea of when you drink anything or consume anything, it's also about the space, the atmosphere, and everything else around you.
Absolutely.
For sure. He's already got it, actually. Santa Maria Novella Station.
Oh, wonderful. Thanks, Steve. Okay, I'm going to take a screenshot of that. Boom. Got it marked down.
Nice.
Yeah, I think to your point, Susie, too, one could argue that the reason why, I don't know, I'm going to make a little off point. I don't know if it's 100% true, right? But of your Portugal experience. But I wonder if sometimes things taste better when we're closer to the people that make it. Because I feel like there's always you're talking about these conversations around like community and like the relationship basically between like people and whatever they're consuming. And I think one thing sometimes that's missed is the conversations around the actual people that are making things, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Who are making beverages that we love, and like High Refinery. and I wonder, like, for me, the things that taste the best is when I really know where it comes from. And sometimes it can be tough, especially like the US, like there's so many laws and logistics and costs, and we're so used to like the Walmart life, but because, or that you get to like those quality, like, you know, intentionally made, but also like worker-based spaces. I don't know, I found more joy.
But it's funny you say that, because I will say, and I feel like a lot of people will agree with me who are watching, is that at the moment we're in like, a lot of the people who are in the special industry, we're in a third wave. And that idea is this whole encompassing idea of where everything comes from. A knowledge of the consumer, of the kind of the production line or like origins of where your coffee came from. Yeah. But then that has also had the double-edged sword of kind of exoticizing it as well. So you exoticize the farmers. It's kind of this neoliberal idea of coffee and such like that. I've seen a little bit in the beer industry, but not much, because it's the idea of where people get their hops and stuff like that as well. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I think I will say I have seen it in the beer industry, and Tony, April, and I'm sure a few other people that I didn't catch that they had joined the live, but you know, they're really tapped into the craft beer market. And, you know, that's the space where people are intentional about the product that they're making, and they're more connected to like the sources that they're getting their product from, and there is far more transparency in all aspects of their process, all aspects of their production. And I do think it's super important, you know, like I hope to build a community that when we talk about inclusivity, when we talk about Black and Brown people, ultimately I'm a firm believer and an advocate for worker justice. And like, because it's often, especially in the US, products are made on the backs of Black and Brown people. You know, when we talk about like labor, we're talking about Black and Brown people. We're talking about immigrant labor, and we're talking, and also Black and Brown immigrants. And so it's hard for me sometimes when people, you know, they talk a good game maybe about their consumption from like a flavor profile or from like a, you know, a taste profile, or maybe like the store that they purchased it from. But then the next level is really like, who were the people that actually made that product? Not only where did you purchase from, like the literal store, and how those workers are treated. Are they compensated fairly? Are they getting the hours? Do they have insurance? You know what I'm saying? But then also the laborers, especially the wine industry, is super guilty of this. You know, I'm not, again, like I always struggle like speaking specifically all, to all the different industries and such, but I can say firmly that in the wine industry, we're definitely having that type of reckoning of like asking ourselves, who are the labor forces? How connected is this brand that I'm interested in? And nowadays, the more money I make, the less money I make even, it really doesn't matter. I'm far more thoughtful. I'm not always perfect. Who's perfect? But I'm definitely far more thoughtful now about, you know, where my products are come from. Same thing, like I walk through my neighborhood. I love Brooklyn and stuff like that. But I definitely, I engage and purchase the places that are local. You know, they're one-off spots, mom and pop shops, mom and pop. That's also a stereotype. Let me just say small business owners, you know? And I could go off and off about like worker justice, because that's a whole deep-seated issue in hospitality.
Yeah. Oh, yes, most definitely. So I just have one more question for you.
Talk to me.
This is from Jen. So she goes, are there any... So we're going back to the idea of space again. Are there any design elements within a cafe or a bar, or even like a drink store, what's what we call them, that signal a space that might be unwelcoming to you or others?
Yeah, that's okay. That's really great. You know, sometimes it's hard to like say it, but you know it when you walk in the door. I take a look sometimes at decorations, like literally like the art on the wall. If it feels, okay. So first I will say, generally speaking, I don't always care too much for like sterile spaces, you know, ones that are like devoid of like conversation and color and energy in that way. So I'm in general leaning towards places that have a little bit more color and vibrancy. The second being, I'm interested in like, what kind of art do you have in your walls? I think that's one of the tail signs of like whether or not a place feels welcoming. I judge a place a lot by, this is a little bit off of what the person said. I think that, right? A little bit off of what Jen was asking, but I also judge heavily by what the menu looks like. Sometimes menus are written in a way that is the ultimate gatekeeper. Like language where I'm like, now you know you trained your staff for months and months on that stupid word. So why do you think your consumer, your everyday regular person is going to walk in and have like a deep knowledge of like, I don't know, foie gras? Like, I don't understand why we can't just break down the foods in a way that, that how we speak on a daily basis. You know what I'm saying? It's like, and that's why I think sometimes when I get food at a restaurant, I was not expecting that plating. I'll be like, this is rubbish. You know, if you had told me that you were going to take like one dry little chicken breast and drizzle it with like some raspberry looking sauce instead of like demi glace with the, you know what I'm saying? Over like, and then you dress it up. I'm like, that's how I miss that. And I work in the industry and sell food and beverage to people every single day. And also, So that's, those would be some of the other things. You, there was a coffee shop I walked into in Chicago. I think they fixed this issue, but I remember walking in, it was all cis white men. And they had this like black hair shop sign. Like it was either like a picture of like an afro or like a black woman getting her hair done in like a particular way, but something that felt super, super, super black. It would not have offended me or weirded me out if there were any black people that actually worked there. I'm like, I have never seen a black person or a brown person work in this coffee shop. I'd been there at least a few times at that point. And when I finally noticed it, I was like, this is really weird and really disturbing. It kind of talks about like what a word I have not said so far in our chat, which is like tokenism, you know, elements to showcase a story or tell a story that either you authentically are not connected to, or one that you're basically not related to whatsoever. I don't mind actually if you put up like my parents are from Nigeria. I don't mind if you put up the Nigerian flag, but if you've never, like, you don't know where Nigeria is, talk less of having hired one that was Nigerian, or know anything about the multitudes of languages, or the fact that English is actually official language or whatever. Like, I don't know. I find it super, it's just weird.
It's just weird. Yeah. Well, it's just offensive, to be honest. Yeah. It's like, it's just reminding me of something that, I had a friend who recently went to visit Paris, and he's black, and he walked past a place that I think it was called like Mr. John's or something, but it had an image of a minstrel, like a minstrel character, like a black 1920s character on like the front of the building. And it was very kind of, it was a well-to-do area and all this kind of stuff. And just that, it's just, it made him feel so uncomfortable. And that's before this person even walks in the door, they know not, they're unwelcomed kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Absolutely. And like, it's, I think it's a thing of like, do you, like, for now, actually we're 5 minutes away. So do you have any kind of finishing thoughts that you would like to kind of touch on?
Yeah. So dismantling the biases that impact our industry in the beverage world, takes work. So I encourage people to get to the work. You know, it takes work to like dismantle our gender biases, our racial biases, and our body biases. That also happens a lot in the food industry. So I encourage people to like do the work and start looking to the people in the industry that are black and brown, especially if we're talking about like racial injustice, and look to them, listen to their voices, follow them. Engage with them, ask them questions in a thoughtful and considerate way. Like, don't waste people's time. Be mindful of the fact that they're fielding and going through a lot of different things, especially in this season. But that would be where I would start. Specifically in the coffee space, I have to pull up my computer, sorry. There's some of my favorites. I wanted to make sure I got everyone. Okay. I think my computer died. Cool. I'll put them in my Instagram story, but two people off of the top of my mind would be the chocolate barista.
Yeah. Michelle Johnson.
Michelle Johnson, yeah. Super wonderful, brilliant human being. Also really funny if you follow them on Twitter. And the coffeetographer, Sharmell. She creates like super beautiful work and is also a great voice in the industry. And thanks, Liana. Cheers to you too. And I would also spotlight, she's not a black woman. She is Latina and white passing Latina, but Boss Barista.
Yes.
If you are, if, yeah, they like,
yeah, I know.
They
it's
are
a small
such
industry.
A, it really is, right? Like, and you know what, Susie? It feels small, I think, for like, especially like you and I, because obviously we're doing the work or we're in those spaces, right? For other people, I think your average consumers, I especially encourage all of y'all, like, you should really go seek out these voices, follow them, engage them, see who they're following, because that's when you'll start to realize that every, you don't need to like do like, there's no magic behind elevating Black and Brown consumers. We're already here. We already exist. We're all around. You know what I'm saying? You just need to open up your eyes and look a little. And like, you'll see that the community is already activated. That was what was so cool about Black Girls Drink, is like, the community already existed of like Black women and Black non-binary people that are active in beverage spaces. I just didn't see them because the industry does such a great job of like squishing them down, you know? So open up your eyes, explore, follow the people that are following them. And I mean, that they're following, and I'm sure that's a really great step. Yeah. As a final point, what else I would say?
I would definitely recommend people to go onto your website for sure.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. For anyone, it's blackgirlsdrink.com, right?
.co.
Should know that. I'm probably acaia.co. To go on your Instagram, to go on your Twitter, because you post stuff all the time.
Thank you.
And we will be putting this up on our IGTV as well.
Thank you.
If anyone would like to watch it again. But yes. I would like to thank you so much for joining me on this.
Thanks, Susie. It's been such a pleasure.
It was just an interesting chat. And I feel we started on a lot of topics that we could go on forever on.
Absolutely.
And I want to thank everyone who is watching as well. If you have any questions for Lola, I would say just DM you on Instagram.
Yeah, pop in my DMs. I'm a totally casual person.
I will let you go back into the Brooklyn sunshine.
Yeah. Thank you so much. I appreciate it, Susie. And I look forward to, I don't know, maybe chatting with you some other time and meeting some new friends.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you so much. I will let you go.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.